I'm Libby Forkham. I've been at Grace for 60 years, and I was married to my wonderful husband, Jim, and I had three sons, Ron, Dan, and Tim. We moved here in 61, and the first time I met Pastor Gay, he was a great pastor, and I was very involved in the church. They called me Sunshine Chairman of the church for many years. I visited the sick. I loved being Sunshine Chairman. After we moved to the Lions Club. Lions Club?
Was it the Moose Lodge?
Thank you. Okay. We had to go in and clean it up after their parties at night, on Saturday night. And I had to leave my little boys in the bar section with Mary Ann Gay. And I went back to the car and I said, Lord, is this where you really want us? But I never went to another church. And the church started praying that we'd find a new home here. The church didn't really grow that much until we moved and bought the property at the college. I think it was the late 60s that we bought the property. This is our first Bible school that we had. My three boys that's in here, that's me right there. Oh, here they are going to camp. And my kid's probably there somewhere. Most of the women here was the membership. We weren't very large then, and we all had to work. We worked together. We had a good bunch of people. Some of them's not here with us anymore, but we'll meet them again. It was a good church. It was a church that people loved each other and looked after each other. We had some rough patches in our church, but we overcome them. Then when Pastor Rince came, we loved him so much. And he was a people person, you know, had a great personality. We were anxious to have a church growing.
How have you seen God be faithful to the people of Grace Baptist for 60 years?
Well, he's been faithful in the growth. He's been faithful in the giving. He's been faithful through heartaches. Before I lost my husband, I lost a son. That's the hardest thing I've ever gone through. I think the Lord just carried me through. And I stayed faithful to the Lord. I questioned him some, but I stayed faithful. He carried me through that.
What would you say to the church family to encourage them this Sunday?
Just keep your eyes on Jesus. Keep the Lord in everything. Honor our Heavenly Father. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory. For the sake of your steadfast love and your faithfulness.
What a blessing it is to be part of the Grace family and to watch the rich tradition and history unfold. Nostalgia is just flying around the room right now for many of you as you look at those pictures and you hear Libby's voice describing the history of God's faithfulness. Well, every week for the next 6 weeks, leading up to the inaugural celebration of our 60th anniversary, we're going to be showing a little slideshow like that with a different decade every single Sunday. And so be prepared to be filled with thankfulness and be blessed by that. Well, this morning, you can get details, by the way, in the Grace Weekly about the 60th anniversary. This morning, we have a wonderful opportunity to hear what we've been doing for 60 years, preaching God's word and putting God's word on display through men that he has equipped and he is gifted to do so. Well, for the first time this morning, I get to introduce Christian Delgado to step into this pulpit for the first time. Christian is our junior high director, and he also oversees the Route 56 ministry. But when Christian first came here, I met him before he was off to college, and he had kind of his eye on a young lady named Samantha Azar that would one day become his wife. And so he's really fallen in love at Grace Baptist Church. He stepped into ministry here at Grace Baptist Church. He's been tutored and mentored by David Haig here at Grace Baptist Church. And now we're going to see all the stuff that God put in him. We're going to see that on display as it's through the power of God, right? Christian's going to bring the word. And so very much looking forward to hearing our brother divide God's word for us. Would you stand with us as we continue in our time of worship?
Well, good morning, Grace. It's good to see you. You know, it's been said as we get into the subject of prayer this morning, we're going to look at prayer in the early church, that the one who sings prays twice. And it's true, right? When we sing, we're praying, we're coming before the Lord. And so my hope this morning is the same intentionality that we would give if we were to close our eyes and go before the Lord, thanking him, confessing sin, adoring him, that we would do the same with our voices, just with melody this morning, with one another. I want to echo what Libby read for us in Psalm 115 as we begin singing. It says, "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory for the sake of your steadfast love and faithfulness." We're going to do that this morning as we sing.
Servant, good and faithful.
Amen. We can arise and we can shine because our triune God has authored the gospel. He's authored redemption from beginning to end, and he's put us right there in the middle of his story to give him glory. Let's be reminded of his mercy in that as we sing King of Kings.
Without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now there's gospel truth.
Declare our dependence on him this morning.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find.
Grace, thanks for singing with us this morning. You can have a seat. And I want to invite up our women's director, Martha Harding, to read our passage for this morning.
Good morning. Please turn with me to Acts chapter 4. I'll start reading in verse 23. When they were released, they went to their friends and reported what the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they heard it, they lifted their voices together to God and said, "Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them, who through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said by the Holy Spirit, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his anointed. For truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, look upon their threats and grant to your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness, while you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus." And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. May God bless us through the reading of his word.
You know, one of my favorite things to do, I guess it turned off while I was sitting down. Sorry about that. One of my favorite things to do when we come into this place on a Sunday morning is I love when we're singing and we're standing. I like looking around the room. I like seeing all of my friends. I like seeing all the people I've come to know over the years being at this church. And I like seeing all the new people that are here and they come. And to be honest, we kind of sometimes make that awkward eye contact with one another and we pretend that like it didn't happen. But the reason I like looking at everyone in this room is because I am amazed that after 2,000 years, God's people have continually come together to worship him. Like, why? From an outsider looking in, it's amazing that this group of people called Christians would come and worship their God in the face of opposition, of continuous opposition. Because even in the early church, especially in the early church, like, they got messed up. They went through some hard times. They experienced persecution from its beginning. Let me remind you of a few of the things that happened to Christians. One of the first leaders in the church, Stephen, proclaimed the gospel, stoned to death. Or we'll see in Acts chapter 12, we have a governmental authority sending military soldiers to go kill one of the disciples with a sword. We also have this dude named Saul who went looking to throw Christians in prison. And then that guy Saul would actually become Paul, and he would face martyrdom under Emperor Nero, who was probably really well known for his persecution at the later end of the first century. Even Peter, a pillar of the faith, he would face martyrdom by crucifixion. All for preaching and teaching Jesus and his resurrection. So we gotta ask ourselves that question, like, what kept these dudes going? Because they didn't just preach and then face martyrdom. Throughout their whole entire lives, they suffered. They were beaten. They were ridiculed. They were sent to prison. They were put on trial. So much throughout their lives that they went through until that point of death. I think we know what kept them going. But let's hash that out a little bit clearer, because I think there's two things that the early church did that kept them going in the faith. And one of them was they clung to one another. They were committed to each other. And then secondly, they prayed. They prayed together and for one another. And God, through the Holy Spirit, used the early church's gathering and their expression of devotion, this thing called prayer, to work in their lives, to stand firm in their faith, and to propel them forward. Thus, this early church prayed because they were a persevering church. And a persevering church is a praying church. And a praying church is a mobilizing church. They continued moving forward in the faith. And so when the early church prayed, especially as what we'll see in Acts chapter 4 today, is that prayer to them wasn't just this spiritual, personal endeavor where they would only go to their rooms and pray for their own sanctification. It was an expression. It was an expression of their new identity, and it was their spiritual life source. It's what gave them life. And prayer for the church, especially in this text, is that it was something different. It was unique compared to the Old Testament. There's a lot of similarities, yes, but the major difference is that prayer for the church was a product of a fulfilled promise. Listen to this in Ezekiel 36. "And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules." They prayed out of their new identity and trust in Jesus through the power that was given to them by God's Spirit dwelling in them. They didn't pray like Israel probably did in exile, hoping for God to return them back into the land, or for that God to make them into a nation as was promised, or for their Messiah to come and redeem them. But that redemption was actualized by the Holy Spirit. And their newfound prayer was standing firm in their faith and a deep desire to gospelize the entire world. This was their prayer, to preach Jesus and his resurrection. Prayer is that expression in us. It's that expression of that working from the Holy Spirit, and it means to keep the community of faith together when the world is against it. Because the early church wanted to persevere in the faith, when all of this stuff happened to them, the response was prayer. And because they prayed, they depended upon God, and it gave them the confidence to continue moving forward, to continue being mobilized together. And that's exactly what our text shows. But what brought them to even pray in the beginning? In Acts chapter 3, we have Peter and John. They're walking around, and they heal a paralytic man. And when the paralytic man was healed, a bunch of people came to them, and they were amazed at what happened. They're like, okay, well, how did this happen? How did you heal this man? Was it you? And then Peter, being Peter, he's like, I'm going to take this opportunity, and I'm going to preach the gospel. I'm going to tell them that it was the God of their forefathers and the Lord Jesus that made this man walk, and you crucified him. You murdered him, but he would also be your savior if you would turn from your wickedness. And then in Acts chapter 4, the captain of the temple and the Sadducees and the priests, they come to Peter and John, and they're annoyed. Why? Because they're teaching Jesus and his resurrection. And so what do? They throw them in prison. They throw them in prison, and the next day they bring him out for a trial, and Peter, once again, boldly proclaims to them the same message that he did to the people. But they didn't believe like the people did. What they did was suppress. And what happened is pretty amazing. They threatened the apostles to not teach Jesus or preach Jesus and his resurrection. And then this is what the apostles say. Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. And you would think that after such a bold statement like that, they would go to the next town over and do just that, to go preach and teach Jesus and his resurrection. But that's not what they do. They go to their friends. Look at it in our text, verse 23. When they were released, they went to their friends and reported what the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they heard it, they lifted their voices together to God. After having been released from prison and charged not to preach Jesus anymore, they go to their own people, they go to their friends, they go to one another, the church, and they told them about the opposition that they were going to face together. And the response to that opposition was prayer. It was prayer. Acts chapter 12, we have Herod, King Herod, kill another disciple with a sword, James. And then because Herod and the religious leaders, they liked that Herod did that, they got a Christian. He actually goes and he's like, okay, well, if you liked how I'm going after Christians, I'll go get another one for you. So who does he go to? He goes and gets Peter and arrests him. And what is the church's response once they arrest Peter? Acts 12:5. So Peter was kept in prison, but earnest prayer for him was made to God by the church. Earnest prayer. And God answers the church's prayer, because as soon as Herod is about to bring out Peter, probably to execute him, an angel of the Lord comes. And Peter doesn't even know if this was like actually happening or if it was just a vision. But when he realizes it was actually real and that an angel of the Lord came to get him out of prison, he goes to the church. He goes to Mary's house. And what the church is doing is they're praying. When the church meets opposition and persecution, they weren't going to their individual homes or closets in this occasion. They weren't going to their sources of entertainment to take their minds off of the things that they just experienced. They were going to one another. They were going to the church, and they heard about what was happening in each other's lives, and then they prayed together. And if we're honest, I think prayer kind of seems like the most counterintuitive thing to do, where we come together and then we bow our heads talking. Talking to our Lord. From an outsider looking in, that's just interesting. Like, maybe we should actually, when we come together, work. Think about what we need to do next to get whoever out of prison. Probably what they were thinking in Peter's day. But that's not the highlight of the text. The text is that it's not about what man can do. It's not about what we can do, but the answer is found in who God is. It's found in the sovereignty of God. And so they prayed because there was nothing better that they could do in that moment. They prayed because there's nothing better that they could do and no one better to look towards. They depended upon the Lord. And so the church prayed to focus their minds together and to remember that the sovereign God is on their side. And so all that they need to do together is to trust him. They need to trust him and lean on each other, lean on one another. And so we're not a praying church if we passively listen to prayer as a transitional piece in a worship service. Nor are we a praying church if we only pray in our rooms and pray for our own sanctification. Though, like, those are, praise the Lord that we're able to do that. Those are good. Those are necessary for our spiritual lives. But God works through the thoughtful, collective, unified prayers of his people as they seek to follow Jesus together. And this is something that we can emulate from the early church and apply it to our current day. And so, look at verse 24 again. And when they heard it, they lifted their voices together to God and said, "Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them, when they face opposition and they gather together and they lifted their voices together with one mind, they looked towards the sovereignty of God." They looked towards who he is. And when they prayed together, it forced them to reflect on God's work and God's word. Look at their prayer. They prayed, "Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them." This is what enabled them to persevere, that they saw everything that was in the world, and they were like, God owns this. And if God created this, then he owns this, and he also sustains it, and he's in control of it. But not only do we know God is truthful, and he's in control, and that he's sovereign by what we see in this world, but we also know because of what he tells us. Look at verse 25. "Who through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said by the Holy Spirit," and they quote Psalm 2. "Why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his anointed." Throughout biblical history, a major theme is that the world has always opposed God's people. I think we all know that. And that what this psalm is doing is that it's stating a sure fact that as the nations conspire together, what they're actually doing is futile. They conspire together to overthrow God's people and the future king, the future anointed king. And the amazing thing about that is it's not going to work. It's not going to work. Because God is laughing in the heavens, and even though they're going to try to oppose them, if they don't submit to God and his anointed king, then their end is destruction. Their church is praying this because instead of the opposition being towards the people of Israel, it's directed towards the anointed king, King Jesus. Right? Jesus faced that opposition already when Pontius Pilate and the people delivered him over to the cross. So no longer is it the surrounding nations that are going to oppose Israel, but they're going after Jesus. And it's not just the Jew or the Gentiles. It's Jew and Gentile. Everyone. Everyone is opposed to him. Verse 27, for truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel. The world is gathered together to oppose your king. And if they're going to oppose your king, how are they going to do that? They're going after those who represent him, us, the church. And this is why we can't be lonely Christians. Because if we're lonely Christians, it's like sending one of us out into a battlefield alone. It's impossible to survive in that reality. And I'm not going to say that we suffer persecution like the early church did. I'm not going to do that. Like, praise the Lord, we don't have presidents sending military soldiers to come kill us with a sword. But what I will say is that, as Pastor Miller said a couple weeks ago, we are increasingly becoming the minority. And that we still suffer from the effects of sin. We still suffer from opposition to those who oppose the gospel message. We still experience those things. We suffer and experience opposition when we have loved ones who are diagnosed with cancer or any terminal illness. Like, we suffer and experience opposition when we have our sons and daughters desire what the world would offer them rather than what their Savior would. Or when they go off to college and they want nothing to do with God or his people. We also suffer and experience opposition when increasingly people that we hold near and dear to our hearts, who we love and care and want to show hospitality to them, they want nothing to do with us because we don't agree with the particular lifestyle. Or maybe it's emotionally, mentally. I think we could all attest to the fact that whatever opposition it might be, either external or internal, that suffering hurts. Suffering is debilitating. Like, we go through seasons where we might not want to go to church as often. We go through seasons where we don't want to read and meditate on God's word. And we, if we're honest, we're probably what takes the biggest hit is our prayer and communion with God. And then when we hear, when people are flourishing in our church and they're spiritually recharged, we say things like, yeah, I need to read my Bible more. Or, yeah, you're right, I need to pray more. Though it may be true, but the real issue is the heart. The real issue is that we're viewing when we say things like that, can say things like that, is that we're acting as though prayer is because it's what God needs rather than what God has given to us. Like, prayer is a gift. Prayer is a privilege. It's a gift given out of our new identity of faith. And through prayer, we are reminded of God's position in our lives. That he is sovereign. That he is in control. And that's why they would pray that even, you know, that the word is true, that people are going to be opposed to you, people are going to be opposed to your king. Inevitably, ultimately, God is going to win. Verse 28. To do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. The opposition, the suffering that we will face in this life is not a surprise to God. But God knows all things that are going to take place, and that should give us a confidence that no opposition is going to work. Nothing is going to work. And so what is his plan? If nothing's going to stop his plan, what is his plan? And that's us. Like, God is working to build up his church. It's you and me, and he works in us through the prayers of his people as they pray for one another, as we pray together to persevere in the faith. And that's how they serve each other. That's how you and I serve each other. So in those seasons of suffering or opposition, pour your heart out to a friend. Go talk to someone about it. Go talk to your spouse about it. Go talk to your discipler or your mentor. Because when we face opposition together, it will not leave us without hope, because we will remind each other of the hope that we have in Christ. And that's what enables us to persevere, because we can hope and pray and trust God together. Listen to these examples from Paul, and as this pattern of when the church faces opposition, we rely upon God, and then he's like, be together in prayer. 2 Corinthians 1, verse 8 through 11, he says, I suffered affliction in Asia, but it was actually good that I suffered this affliction, because it allowed me to rely upon God more. But he's like, you can serve one another by this. Verse 11, you also must help us by prayer, so that many will give thanks on our behalf for the blessing granted us through the prayers of many. Or at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18 through 19, he's like, the opposition is real from spiritual powers. Like, we're going to face that, but we rely upon God by putting on our spiritual armor. And then what does he say? Verse 18, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. Like, this is why the church gathers and prays together, for this end. Because in the context of relationship, praying together focuses our efforts on who God is, and that enables us to persevere. A persevering church is a praying church. And prayer is unique, because I'm making the argument here that we actually have to come together and pray with one another. Like, we got to take from Acts chapter 12, when they came to their friends and prayed and lifted their voices together to God. Because, praise the Lord, right? We do have technology. I can easily just send a text. We can send emails to one another, and that's a great thing. Praise the Lord that we are able to be in constant communication through text messaging and prayers and phone calls. Those are all good, and praise the Lord for that. You know, we got to actually read them, though, because I'm pretty guilty of that. But that seems easy. It seems distant. Praying together requires a level of vulnerability, of transparency. It sometimes can require a confession of sin, or requires us letting our walls down and being vulnerable with one another. And that could reveal that we aren't the most perfect individuals or families. And so when we actually do pray together, it can kind of be superficial, unintentionally. You know, I was working in the B building, and I was cleaning in one of the classrooms, and I hear crying outside the door. It's after services. It's probably around 12:30. And I hear crying out in the hallway, and I walk outside, and I see these two moms. One mom is crying, and you can tell that she's just going through a hard time in her life, and she was hurting. She was going through something. But then I saw another woman, another mom, and she had her hand on her shoulder, and they were both bowing their heads, and they were praying together. No one around them. Like, that's a beautiful thing to see, because when you think about it, how did that interaction even take place? I can imagine that they were both going to pick up their kids from the classroom, and then they're making small talk as they're waiting in line to grab their children, and then one of them just simply asks, how are you doing? And then because that mom, knowing that she could probably trust this other mom, that they probably had a relationship with one another, decided to let her walls down and to actually share with her how she really felt. And from there, the moms sometimes, you know, we just don't know what to say to one another when we're hurting. And it can be a good thing. Why? Because the only thing that we could do in those moments is pray. We just say, let's go to the Lord. Let's reflect on how good our God is through prayer and that he is in control. And so praying separately, praying together, it's not an either or, but it's a both and. Because the importance of praying together is that it focuses our prayer upon our greater purpose as God's people to serve each other. Because let's be honest, if we're not in relationships with one another here, we would have no reason to pray for others. We would only pray for ourselves. Think about it. I was just praying with multiple groups. And notice how when we pray in the context of proximity and being together, that we don't really pray for ourselves. We pray for those around us. Because it'd be kind of weird for us to gather together and then pray for ourselves. It's natural for us. There's a natural inclination for us to take the focus out of ourselves and to focus on what God is doing through the church, through the people who are around us. And ultimately what this does is when we are others focused in our prayers become missionally focused. And when we become missionally focused together, it spiritually recharges all of us. It does something to encourage us. Because listen to this. After Paul in Ephesians tells them to pray together, this is what he asks for. Pray also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel. Perseverance is always so that we could fulfill our gospel purpose, to proclaim the good news of Jesus. And so I think we should all pray for us to get into that great school. I think we should pray for all of us to ask God to provide for us financially or for whatever we need in our lives that we value or are important in our individual lives, right? Praise God that we are able to come before his throne as sons and daughters of him and that he listens to us. But all of our personal requests should focus us back to fulfilling our mission, which is God's mission. That is to proclaim the gospel boldly. And nothing quite does that than doing it together. Look at the early church in verse 29. And now, Lord, look upon the threats. And grant to your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness, while you stretch out your hand to heal and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. Corporate prayer directs us to view our lives as missional. The church should collectively desire to continue to speak the gospel in boldness, not being ashamed of the gospel, but heralding it as ours and the world's only hope. And this doesn't mean that the gospel is dependent upon us, that salvation is dependent upon us. Because in verse 30, God is the one doing the work. God is the one that's doing signs and miracles to proclaim his name. He's getting the glory. He's doing the all work. He is building up his church all for his glory and the exaltation of Jesus. He's doing that. But the key concept, though, is this, that as the gathered people depend upon God through prayer to persevere, the Holy Spirit, through the prayers of his people, mobilizes them. Because look what happens as they prayed this. Verse 31. And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they continued to speak the word of God with boldness. You see, God gives his people what they ask and what they need according to his will because it's for his mission. The Holy Spirit makes his presence known and he fills up the place of wherever they were at. The Holy Spirit makes his presence known and God answers their prayers and that they actually will continue to speak the gospel in boldness. That they would continue living for Jesus and preaching and teaching Jesus and his resurrection. That's what God does in the work of his people, in the lives of them. But what prompted them and recharged them was the fact that they were mobilized to come and pray together and for one another first. They went to their friends. They went to their own people. This is why they were all filled together. No one was left out. And they all continued to speak the word of truth and boldness to continue living and preaching Jesus and his resurrection. So it's by the Spirit, purely by the Spirit, that Peter would preach the gospel at Pentecost. Right, it's by the Spirit that Peter and John, after being faced in the opposition that they had, being arrested, and the Sadducees being greatly annoyed with what they're teaching, that they would say that in the face of their opposition, I'm not going to but speak and preach of what I have seen and what I have heard. It is also by the Spirit that Peter, after he and the angel of the Lord had a prison break, that he would continue preaching the gospel and shepherding God's people. That's what the Spirit does. But we also got to understand that the Spirit, though he enables us to boldly proclaim the gospel, he does use us as his people to encourage one another. And that is why we can say something like this, that it is also by the Spirit that I have seen, and I know many of you have seen, people in this church praying for one another. Or when I saw that mom in the hallway taking a moment out of her day after the end of services, when no one was around in the B building hallway, that she would die to her sense of time, and that she would encourage another Christian, another sister in Christ, through prayer, to encourage her for the week ahead, and then to continue praying for her later on. God, by his Spirit, mobilizes his church, his people, to boldly proclaim to one another, but also to recharge one another. Like, if we are not a people who are enlivened by the opportunity to proclaim the gospel to each other, then what makes us think that the Spirit is going to use us to boldly proclaim it to an opposing world? It begins with us. And we see this pattern many New Testament passages when we pray, that we think of others' faith. And what this does is that it spiritually charges us to continue moving forward in faith. Hence, in Acts chapter 4, they pray together. They ask God for boldness together. And then he answers their prayers and spiritually recharges them. Listen to these examples. Ephesians 1. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you. He was filled with thankfulness, remembering you in my prayers. 2 Timothy 1, I thank God whom I serve as did my ancestors with a clear conscience as I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you, that I may be filled with joy. Philemon 4 through 7, I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers because I hear of your love and of the faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Like, all of these examples point us to a reality that we need one another to pray for one another. That we serve each other through our prayers for one another. Why? Because we believe that God answers them and that he gives us a boldness to continue on in the faith and then to boldly proclaim the gospel to each other and to an opposing world. That's why we pray. A praying church is a mobilizing church. And so, Grace Baptist, how can we be a people who pray together and persevere and are mobilized together by prayer? And I just want to say this, don't miss out on the opportunities. That day, as I saw those two moms in the hallway, the only reason I was able to witness that was because I had a volunteer call out late. I had a couple moms and dads pick up their kids late. Otherwise, like, lunch was calling. And as I walked out, I said a little prayer, and I'm not gonna say that I was either right or wrong, but what I will say is that I probably missed out on an amazing opportunity to show togetherness in this church. Because what an opportunity that could have been for me to just go up to that mom and say, hey, I don't know what you're going through, I don't know what's going on, and you don't have to tell me, but let me just go to our God in prayer with you to encourage you in the gospel and to reflect on the sovereignty of God. This story and our text made me realize that I've probably missed out on a lot of opportunities to pray with the church because I'm always thinking about the next thing we got to get to after service. Church, don't miss out on the opportunities here when we gather. Meaning, be presently here. Be intentional. When you're saying hello to your friends, ask them intentionally those questions of how are you doing. Spend a little more time talking with people on a Sunday morning. This is our opportunity and this is our time to seek out those times to rapport and pray with one another for perseverance, for boldness, for strength, and for joy. Sunday morning is it. This is our time to be together. And if we don't miss out on those opportunities when we are here, and it means that we must build relationships with one another. Praying requires relationship. Praying together requires relationship. Think about it. I'm not going to come up to you if I don't know you, and I'm not going to pour out everything that's going on in my life if I don't know you. You don't know me, and I don't know you. But if we actually know each other's faith, then it makes it much easier to build a relationship founded upon that. I know that you would boldly preach the gospel to me if I need it, or that you would lovingly pray for me in your moments of prayer together or alone. And so that whatever I tell you, I know that you're going to give me gospel-centered encouragement and prayer. And so it starts with having relationships with people in this church. It starts with asking intentionally those questions of how are you doing, or how can I pray for you? How can I come alongside you? What can you tell me how I can encourage you in the hope of the gospel that we have, right? It begins with asking those intentional questions. And then if you're being asked those questions, it means letting your walls down, being transparent, being open, trusting that the brother or sister that is asking is not out to get you, but that we're actually here to serve you, to help you. And then when we build those relationships, there's going to be mutual encouragement, because there's an understanding that when we are unified together and we trust that God will answer our prayers, then we'll be filled with joy. We'll be filled with thankfulness, and we'll be spiritually refreshed through one anothering. In this little book on prayer, the author describes prayer as an expression of faith, and that true faith comes from hearing the words of Christ. And it got me thinking, like, when we gather together, we're singing songs of Christ. We're hearing the word preached. If we're not missing out on those opportunities of listening to one another, then that probably means that you're hearing God's work in other people's lives. And then if you're hearing other people's the work of God in other people's lives, then that should cause us to reflect on what God is doing in our own hearts and our own minds. What other opportunity or response do we have than to pray together on a Sunday morning? When this is all that we do, we worship our Lord. And for some of us, this is the only time where we get to be together with God's people. Seize that moment. Seize the opportunity to come together, to be intentional, to build relationships, to pray for encouragement, for boldness, and for strength. And if we do this, Grace family, enjoy experiencing the unity of Christ as God's family in the work of Christ in every area of your life. The early church asked God for boldness together, and God granted them their requests, to the point that in the very next verses of what Pastor Jared talked about last week, they were of one heart, of one's soul and had everything in common. They were encouraged to the point that they worked to take care of one another to accomplish the mission. They truly were a family, and prayer was an expression of their familial love for one another. God encourages us by unifying our efforts as one family on one mission. So we don't only tell each other the opposition, but we tell each other and we pray and celebrate God's answered prayers in our lives and in each other's lives. We pray and celebrate what God is doing through missionary work. We pray and celebrate what God is doing through the conversations that we have with family members or for friends or when we are neighboring. We tell each other this and pray together to experience the close unity that we have in Christ. And this is God's heart for his people, that they would enjoy experiencing him together. So let's be a people who persevere together by praying with one another, looking toward the sovereignty of God together, so that we could boldly proclaim the gospel together. And all this is really is that prayer is an expression of being faithful. Be faithful, and you will pray. Enjoy seeing the Spirit of God work through Grace Baptist Church when you are faithful. Amen. I'd like to transition us to a time of prayer. Why? Because after talking about prayer, it kind of just seems natural that we would actually pray together. And what I would like is I'd like to encourage you to pray out loud. Let's emulate. There's going to be prayer prompts on the screen, and they're going to transitionally slide through the three prayer points that we have. But the goal of this is really to do what the early church did, to be unified together in our prayer and to lift our voices to God together. So why don't you go ahead, pray with one another. Pray out loud if you don't feel comfortable. And then I'll close this. Heavenly Father, hear our prayers. As we lift up our voices together to you, Lord, I don't know what everyone is going through. I don't know the oppositions we all face, but what I do know is that we are together. And I love each and every one of my brothers and sisters in Christ here, Lord, and I pray that they would persevere and stand firm in their faith. That they would rejoice that we have a privilege to pray to you as sons and daughters. And that we have the privilege to come together to hear your word, to reflect on your work, to reflect on how true your word is and how that enables us to continue moving forward in the faith, to boldly proclaim the gospel. That is our prayer as God's people. I pray that each and every one of us in this room will continue being spiritually recharged and refreshed on this given Sunday to prepare them for Monday through Saturday of living out in the world, of living gospel-centered lives and taking every moment and every opportunity to love on their neighbors and their friends and to share with them the love that we have in Christ and that they can have it too, if they would just believe. God, continue making us faithful people who rely upon your word and who rely upon one another. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks, Christian. Thanks for serving us so well this morning. Christ was honored. Would you stand with us this morning? Prayer truly is a privilege, and we get a chance to respond singing these words. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer.
Jesus.
blessing before the throne.
Before the throne.
Refreshing it has been to our souls to both proclaim and to practice our dependency on the Lord united in our hearts together. I want to remind us that as we think and as we go and making plans for the week, we want to remind you that we're going to be having a volunteer training day. One of the ways that we practice life together is by serving alongside one another, and so we have this volunteer training day. Now, this is for everybody. If you are serving in any capacity, in any way, come. We're going to be together for the majority of the morning from 8:30 to noon. We're going to have breakfast. We're going to get a chance to sing together, to look at God's Word together with Pastor David, as well as pray together. And then we're going to have important announcements and investments and some training in each one of the areas. So if you're currently serving, if you'd like to serve, come on Saturday the 21st. We would love to have you. If you want some more information or things that are happening on campus, check out your Grace Weekly, sign up for the digital edition, and also you can stop by the Engage Center. That's the place there on the patio with the two welcome pillars. For those of us who are here that are new or new-ish, please stop by. We'd love to visit and to chat with you and to share with you all that God is doing here at Grace Baptist Church. And if you are new, we also have a gift for you, so stop on by and to enjoy that as well. Listen, thank you so much for your generous gifts, the ways in which that you support the ministry here. We do have those giving stations out in the lobby for you, or for those of you who are giving online. Thank you so much for doing that even today. For those of you who have a spiritual need, if we can pray with you, if we can minister to you, right down here to my right, your left, there are going to be some folks here who be pleased to serve you and to pray with you as we close our time together. Now let's end our time in a prayer of benediction. Join with me. Now may we go and walk worthy of the calling to which we have been called in Christ Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit, according to the sovereign decrees of our Father God, who hears our prayers that unite our hearts together in one hope as a people who are zealous for good works, in true worship to God's glory and not our own. Amen. Grace to you. Have a great week.
The power of our God, you shine in the shadow, you win every battle, nothing can stand against the power.